Why are you doing this?
You did this to yourself. And admitting that is the first step. You're a crackhead. Thing is, this planet and these people, they're your drug of choice. It wasn't that hard to make a universe. At first you just checked in every once in a while. See how the Neanderthals were doing. Move a couple of continents around. But then you got more into it. You started playing a couple of characters of your own. Slaves, kings, messiahs. Pretty soon you were playing 24/7.
How long have I been?
You've been gone for 4,000 years. Not that time means the same for us.
You came looking for me.
That's what a girl does.
Why now?
Because you forgot who you were.
They forgot this wasn't real.
We couldn't just storm in on a fiery chariot. It was your universe. We had to play by your rules. We had to show you how limited and corrupt your little world was. Don't get me wrong, it's a nice place. It's cozy. But do you remember where you came from?
It was warm and white.
You can't describe it with human words.
You can't think it with human thoughts.
We need you to come back. With us. Come back with me.
That was from the movie The Nines, with Ryan Reynolds and Melissa McCarthy, with a bit of a spoiler. It's very Gnostic because it echoes the spiritual thrust of the ancient Sethians and Valentinians. God went crazy. Forgot he was God and became us. Probably happened through self-knowledge, as it always does. And now that we realize this cosmic truth, we must become part of the restoration of creation and restore its very sanity. As Ralph Waldo Emerson said, a man is God in ruins. When men are innocent, life shall be longer, and shall pass into the immortal, as gently as we awake from dreams.
I'm sorry, what was that again?
I'm a god.
You're a god.
I'm a god, not the god, I don't think.
And the best place to begin remembering your divine sanity is right here, at Aeon by Gnostic Radio. Broadcast from the virtual Alexandria, that state of mind where East meets West, and through the God above God, Dad Kim.
Do not panic! Do not panic! We are trained professionals!
AM by Gnostic Radio is proud to present another entry to its widely popular Schrodinger's Diary. On this September 7th, the year of our Demiurge 2013. Schrodinger's Diary is our ongoing chronicle of Anthony Peake's cheating the ferryman hypothesis. Here we are, seemingly trapped in labyrinths of myriad realities, eternally reoccurring and eternally begetting, reincarnated and recycled in a vast predatory universe. But there is hope to escape the black iron prison if we find a way to not board Karen's boat this one time outside of time. The cat is out of the bag, the box of time and space, dead and alive, and we're getting out with them. As the cat has probably realized, this is a computer video game constructed by Jehovah and his archons. Similar to the movie The Nines.
As long as the Matrix exists, the human race will never be free.
For more information on Anthony, a great game hacker of reality and crusader ally of AM by Gnostic Radio, on his stellar books and projects, please visit anthonypeake.com. That is Anthony, P-E-A-K-E. And check out Aeon Byte's iTunes main player and YouTube for past episodes of Schrodinger's Diary with some of the greatest heretical mystics of our era.
By the power of truth, I, while living, have conquered the universe.
Welcome, you Johnny Cash Bodhisattvas, you stealth messiahs, and you grunge homoplasmates. Prepare to lose your mind and come to your senses. Prepare to enter the desert of the real and find your own personal palm tree garden. Prepare to go into the greatest adventure of your many incarnations, finding out who you really are and what reality is not.
Wise man once told me, don't ask questions you don't want to know the answer to.
I think Carl Jung put our sacred and profane mission very well when he said, your vision will become clear only when you look into your heart. Who looks outside dreams. Who looks inside awakens. Furthermore, in the Gospel of Thomas, Jesus says, if those who lead you say to you, see, the kingdom is in the sky, then the birds of the sky will precede you. If they say to you, it is in the sea, then the fish will precede you. Rather, the kingdom is inside of you, and it is outside of you. When you come to know yourselves, then you will become known, and you will realize that it is you who are the sons of the living Father. But if you will not know yourselves, you dwell in poverty, and it is you who are that poverty.
Be without fear in the face of your enemies. Be brave and upright that God may love thee. Speak the truth always, even if it leads to your death. Safeguard the helpless and do no wrong. That is your oath.
I am, and I am Abraxas, that terrible god above god as the ancients knew him. In his meat space incarnation of Miguel Connor, as I make contact with you in cyberspace. I am your pompous of gnosis and smell of colitis rising up through the choked air of a toxic planet polluted in so many ways by hating angels and their greedy concubines in the establishment. And you are Abraxas too, and we are one. But divided we stand, together we rise.
Yes, these are bruises from fighting. Yes, I'm comfortable with that. I am enlightened.
On this entry of Schrodinger's diary, we will be discussing the exemplar and modern Gnostic sage Philip K. Dick. Not by far the first time we've done it in either Schrodinger's diary or Aeon Byte, but perhaps the most decisive and foundational. Anthony has just released his new book, The Man Who Remembered the Future, A Life of Philip K. Dick. It's not your usual Philip K. Dick biography, and there are many excellent ones out there, but one that approaches the great Dick from a, surprise, Gnostic slant, by doing a tripartition of his being and narrative into body, soul, and spirit, or more like life, psychology, and mysticism. And Dick's life is remarkable in each of these three aspects. By doing this, Anthony found new insights in the bardos of Dick's existence and solidifies the ancient Gnostic essence into a modern context. A message that is more relevant than ever, as the Archons further take humanity into a deeper waking nightmare, making us fall completely asleep at the wheel of runaway technology.
We are living in a computer programmed reality, and the only clue we have to it is when some variable is changed and some alteration in our reality occurs.
Funny how the technology we're using right now, at this moment, is built on slave labor in Asia and other places. Just as America's built on not just dreams, but the blood and pain of other civilizations. But that's the way Samuel built the system. A loaded game. In an eternal double bind. The mosquito biting the bronze elephant concept of the Buddhists. where we're stuck in dark paradox no matter what we do. Unless we gain the gnosis to defeat fate and get out of the loaded game. That's what it comes down to it in the end.
And the attitude is not to withdraw from the world when you realize how horrible it is, but to realize that this horror is simply the foreground of a wonder. And come back and participate in it.
But back to Philip K. Dick. There is no doubt now that Dick owes his visions and prophecies and just plain good parody on the ancient Gnostics themselves. There is so much evidence, but as he himself says in his exegesis, I think anyone versed in Gnosticism who reads my notes would say, "You're a Gnostic. I'm not happy about this, but it is so, based on 2374. Simon Magus lives. And Simon Magus lives in all of us, for we are all fathers of all heresy at Aeon Byte Gnostic Radio and Schrodinger's Diary. And we're remembering we are God who went crazy.
Ray, when someone asks you if you're a God, you say, yes!
I always like to bring this quote from The Man in the High Castle, which typifies the rulers of this world and all the minions of orthodoxy. They want to be the agents, not the victims of history. They identify with God's power and believe they are godlike. That is their basic madness. They are overcome by some archetype. Their egos have expanded psychotically so that they cannot tell where they begin and the Godhead leaves off. It is not hubris, not pride. It is inflation of the ego to its ultimate. Confusion between him who worships and that which is worshipped. Man has not eaten God. God has eaten man.
You are specks of dust beneath our fingernails. Your very breath is a gift from Olympus. You have insulted powers beyond your comprehension.
Other than that, not much of my drivel, my beloved truth seekers. I'm getting my arse kicked by the Archons, and sometimes sodomized without a reach around. I'm working three jobs that include doing ghost hunting for Chicago ghost investigations and being part of a startup that offers holistic services to the disabled. All this to make ends meet and get ready for the wife unit to deliver our blessed son at the end of September. For this, I'm getting behind in my promises of the Aeon Byte 2.0 initiative, even if equipment and a new website are basically a reality and around the corner. Voices of Gnosticism too will also take longer for various reasons, many beyond my control. For the delays, I apologize, but I am making sure all the funds go to the reboot, as promised, and thus have to work those extra jobs.
Shop smart. Shop S-Mart.
In any event, please keep supporting in any way you can. Regardless, the revolution in the name of Hypatia of Alexandria continues as this Hobbit podcast continues to deliver to you the gospel of Bill Hicks and the eternal soundtrack of the counterculture.
You need to go, don't you?
No. I can stay.
How long? Forever? Every day you'd be here, you'd know what you were missing. What happens if you go?
The worst case scenario? Disintegration of everything into a fiery void. Oblivio a sebit. The end of everything.
That's all?
That probably wouldn't happen. I guess I'm more worried about the human factor. You guys kill each other a lot.
In fairness, that's usually in your name. Plus, we've gotten much more efficient at it.
I like this world. I like my life here with you in the well.
But it's not real. I'm not really your wife. I'm not really my husband. On some level, it's all pretend. How many versions were there?
90. This is the last one.
Wow.
I've destroyed billions of people with the thought. And you'd like to think that it's painless?
Stop. You don't have to explain or apologize. Everything that is because of you. And if that's all there is, that's enough.
So,
guess you don't really need to pack anything.
I'm good.
You're great. It has been a pleasure.
Likewise. I love you.
I love you too. You bug.
This is AM Byte Gnostic Radio, and we are proud to present the next diary entry of Schrodinger's Diary, where Anthony Peake and I and our guests discuss the mysteries of the universe. How are you doing today, Anthony?
I'm very well, thanks, Miguel. And how are you?
I'm doing great. And you are here to discuss your wonderful new book, The Man Who Remembered the Future, A Life of Philip K. Dick. And I found it an incredible read. I would highly recommend this biography to everyone, especially because of the slant you bring to it. So, Anthony, was this sort of a dream come true for you, writing this book? Is this where you said, I have arrived?
Totally. I mean, I've been fascinated by the writings of Philip K. Dick for many, many years. In fact, when I was a teenager, I read a lot of his novels. And then there was a period of time when I didn't read any science fiction. And it was only probably around about the time of the writing of my first book that I started to reread Philip K. Dick and suddenly found so many areas of overlap between his own interests and mine. And when my publisher Arcturus one day over lunch, and they said, right, okay, we would be interested in you writing a book on Philip K. Dick, I couldn't believe it. You know, it was the idea, because normally you have to pitch ideas to publishers. But there was my publisher turning around and saying, we would like to have you write a book on Philip K. Dick. And because the editor I worked very closely with, Nigel Matheson, is a great Philip K. Dick fan as well. So it was wonderful because the editor appreciated where I was going with it and indeed was very, very helpful in a lot of the areas as well. So it was absolutely wonderful project. And as you say, it was a dream come true.
And there are obviously many biographies on Philip K. Dick by many august scholars, and you rub shoulders with many of these scholars. So for a person that, what is different about this biography, or what makes it stand out, or what niche does it have?
Okay, well, what I've tried to do with this particular book is to make it more than a straightforward biography. In other words, there is the first part of the book is biographical because it has to be in order to put into place the events that took place in Phil's life and, in fact, the esoteric elements of Phil's life. But we needed the biography section. But I readily admit that, you know, there are far better biographies written of Phil's life than my own. And indeed, because of the way in which the book was written, I read all of the available biographies and many other snippets of information about Phil's life and incorporated them within the biographical section. But where I think I would like to believe I value add is that I'm actually trying to place Phil in his role, his intellectual role, in his role as a thinker, in his role as an influencer of ideas and thoughts. So effectively, what I do is I very much go into great detail of exactly why, what themes did he pick up on, which great thinkers influenced him, and why did he pick up on these particular elements, and which novels did he incorporate them into. But on top of that, what I've always wanted to do was to make the book a progress from my previous books, in that I'm interested in the further reaches of human psychology and human experience. So I was very much interested in focusing in on Phil's theophany, his 2374 experiences, and also evaluating evidence that Phil himself was precognitive. And I was stunned as to how much material and information I was able to glean to show that Phil, in fact, did seem to have elements of his life that were in many ways a reflection of his own writing and his own ideas.
bring an astounding amount of evidence. We could spend all day, but for example, one thing that is impressive is most people assume, well, Philip K. Dick tragically or left this earth or went to his daemon very early. But as you point out, there was a lot of evidence that Phil knew that his time was coming.
Oh, bizarrely so, yes. And because I was in the fortunate position of being able to speak to some of the major characters in Phil's life, I was able to elicit material from the horse's mouth, as it were. And I have to say, in this particular case, you know, Tessa Dick had been wonderfully helpful in terms of helping me position certain events that have been reiterated time and time again. But it did seem to me that Phil did seem to be aware of the fact, or subliminally part of him knew that he wasn't going to live very long. And I'm intrigued particularly by one particular event that, in fact, I cited in my book, The Daemon, but I expanded upon it far greater in this book, where Phil wrote a letter to his pen pal, Claudia Krenz, or Claudia Krenz Bush, or Claudia Bush as she now is, Dr. Claudia Bush, who also was extremely helpful, by the way, because I was in contact with her as well. And he wrote a series of letters to Claudia. And in one of the particular letters, there is a typewritten section on the bottom of the letter where he turns round and he says, and I'm paraphrasing, that Claudia, I think I'm becoming precognitive because last night in a very, very powerful hypnagogic session, I saw underwater cities, I saw various things. Then I saw one plain, stark image of a man lying flat on his stomach between a coffee table and a sofa, dying, basically. Now, what is intriguing is that what 4 or 5 years later, Tim Powers and his associates were concerned because Phil had not turned up at their regular weekly meeting that they used to have. And again, I've had details from Tim about this event as well, you know, because Tim witnessed it. And where they were concerned about Phil, so they went round to his condo and had to break the door down. And when they broke the door down, they entered the condo to find Phil lying flat on his stomach between a chair, a table settee, and a coffee table. Now, this to me is extremely bizarre. You know, the idea that he saw the circumstances of his own death from an out-of-the-body location, i.e. he was hovering above the body, looking down at his own body. Now, again, what intrigued me about this was that if my overall hypothesis of the Daemon Eidolon Dyad and the idea that the Daemon in some way remembers the elements of our past lives, but if the Daemon is a manifestation of consciousness and a manifestation of the brain, how, if Phil never regained consciousness between the time he was found in the condo and the time he actually died about 4 or 5 days later, if he never regained consciousness, how would the Daemon ever manifest the information within the brain? Now, I spoke to Tessa about this, and Tessa assures me that she visited Phil in hospital, and counter to the general suggestions, she said he was conscious. He was looking at her, and he was showing interest in what she was doing. His eyes were following her, and he was looking directly at her. And she was convinced that he was aware. At least on one of the visits. On the second visit, he'd gone. Although the body was there, she said clearly Phil was no longer there. So in which case, this very much reiterates that this was part of his memory programs of his previous life, which then were manifest in his new life. And when he's having this strange hypnagogic effect, it was his Daemon effectively warning him, saying, Phil, be very, very careful, because this is what's going to happen to you. But there are other evidence. There were various other things that he said to various people in the run-up to his untimely death, where he was convinced he was on the way out. I mean, Tess has cited various examples to me where there were things he was saying that clearly he was realizing that something was about to happen to him that was going to be powerful and probably the end of his run through this particular run of this life.
Again, your book is really an amazing encyclopedia of research and evidence. For example, one thing that maybe a lot of people know, and it certainly ties in with your research, is that you are very interested in the effects of DMT and the pineal gland. But Phil was also on the same path, wasn't he?
Oh, it amazes me and it stuns me. One of the things that I found, I mean, for the research of the book, and I would like to thank strongly my good friend Nick Buchanan for this, because Nick is an absolute erudite PKD scholar, and he has all the books, and he had some of the books that I would have struggled to have got hold of because they're just not available these days. The Scott Appel book, for instance. And Nick also sent to me all the bound Philip K. Dick letters, the selected letters of Philip K. Dick. So I was in the position that I could actually read up in detail a lot of the things that he was thinking about in his letters. And also from there, I was also incredibly fortunate, because one of the things I always find in my writing is just how the timing is always perfect. Had I decided to write a biography of Philip K. Dick or a book about Philip K. Dick 6 or 7 years ago, I wouldn't have had access to the exegesis, for instance, which has only comparatively recently been published, you know, 800 pages of notes that Phil made. But it's within this exegesis that if you are looking for the clues and you know what to look for and you are inside Phil's head, as I'd like to believe I became, because I spent, you know, a year reading absolutely everything about him, reading his letters, talking to his friends and everything else, I came to the conclusion at certain stages that I was almost melding into becoming Phil, because I was thinking like him in so many ways. It was quite strange. But if you read through the exegesis, you will see time after time his fascination with the idea of the third eye and the pineal gland and the chemicals within the pineal gland and such like. He's intrigued by this. He has line drawings within the exegesis where he draws pictures of beings that look like greys, and these greys have a third eye in the center of their forehead. He discusses in great detail exactly the what this third eye means, what it symbolizes. And interestingly enough, he wrote a little known short story called The Eye of the Sibyl. And in this short story, if you are, again, if you've spent time reading Phil's background, this story is amazingly autobiographical. But on top of that, it has some very, very powerful images of how Phil saw the world. For instance, he claims that, you know, he's two personalities. There's one personality that's living in ancient Rome, and this personality is being manipulated by these beings with three eyes. And these beings are aliens of one description or another. And indeed, if you then carry this on to Phil's ideas about the plasmate and the homoplasmate and a lot of the things that came out of Valis, you're suddenly seeing here the guy's writing about DNA. He's writing about the idea of something deep within DNA itself that carries messages through. Then this, of course, is exactly some of the latest research that's being done by researchers into DMT, ayahuasca. I'm citing, for instance, the example of the writings of people like Jeremy Narby in his book, The Cosmic Serpent, where Narby discusses the serpent symbolism, the DNA symbolism. And in my own book that's due out almost coincidentally with the Philip K. Dick book, a book called The Infinite Minefield. So again, Phil was, I mean, one of the things that stunned me was that when I finished The Infinite Minefield and I started writing the book on Phil, the one thing I thought was, here are two totally separate books. The themes are going to be completely different. One is going to be a biography. It's going to be about Phil's work, his life and everything else. But there's going to be no parallels or no mirror images between one book to the other. But as I was writing the Philip K. Dick book, I suddenly realized that it's actually almost a companion volume to The Infinite Minefield, because what it does is it actually personalizes the experiences that I discuss in The Infinite Minefield in one individual. And Philip K. Dick, all through my writing, has embodied virtually every theme I write about. The Daemon Eidolon Dyad, the interest in Gnosticism, the interest in the idea of reality as an illusion, the idea that the way the brain has two sections to it, the way we have the idea of bicameralism, the writings of Julian James. I could go on and on and on. And Phil was there every time, virtually every theme I write about. If you look it up, it's in there in the exegesis.
Oh, I agree. And it seems he was basically a natural-born mystic and certainly a natural-born Gnostic. Most people believe that it was only in the 70s when he started getting into the Nag Hammadi library and his 2374 experience that he was into Gnosticism. But as you point out, is in a book, the Galactic Pot Dealer, he was already hitting those themes long before anybody knew of the Nag Hammadi library.
Do you know, the Galactic Pot Healer book stunned me. Again, it was a book I'd read many years ago and hadn't really picked up the nuances because my own knowledge of certain things had not expanded enough to actually really see the genius of the book. And not only is it Nag Hammadi and everything else, but it's actually going back to deep, deep Kabbalistic belief systems as well. And again, in my book, The Infinite Mindfield, I cite the work of a rabbi called Joel Baxt, a guy that's out in Manitou Springs, out in Colorado. And Joel is one of the talking heads on the movie DMT, The Spirit Molecule, the movie written and directed by Mitch Schultz. And Joel has spent his whole life just reading esoteric Judaism and the Kabbalah, going into the mystical symbolism of the Kabbalah. And in Joel's books, he very much talks, and his writings, he talks about the idea of the pot that has been broken, the shattered pot, the thing that contains the elements of the Or Ein Sof, the infinitude that is God. And here we have Phil in Galactic Pot Healer writing these incredibly complex, incredibly esoteric ideas within a science fiction novel that stands on its own as a science fiction novel. But of course, there's more to it than that, isn't there? You know, that it's not just a science fiction novel. It's Phil putting across his ideas in the most wonderful way of telling a tale and a story that anybody can read. You know, and he wrote that in 1969. You know, so we've got something that is peculiarly powerful. But, you know, we look at some of his other books as well, and The Cosmic Puppets, for instance. You know, you read The Cosmic Puppets and you've got fractionalization of personality, you've got levels of reality within levels of reality. You know, the guy, my appreciation of Philip K. Dick is now as high as it could possibly. Intellectually, he was amazing, absolutely amazing.
Beyond his great prose, because we can't forget he's a very, very good writer. Why do you think he's so popular today? Is it because he hits on so many themes? Sometimes I think it's maybe his greatest strength is because he really understands human relationships. Through all this mysticism and drama and everything, he really gets intimate with the human heart.
Yeah, that's what's intriguing about Phil's writing. One of the things I did as part of my research was to read a handful of his mainstream novels and understanding whether he had an ability to gauge human personality. Because one of the major criticisms of Phil by general critics is that he's not a terribly good writer of people. He's not a terribly good writer of, say, female characters. You know, one of the major criticisms that made many, many times on him. But effectively, if you read, for instance, Transmigration of Timothy Archer, and here you will have a very, very strong female character in that, the central character, because it's written from a woman's viewpoint. It's actually written in the I form, which is unusual for Phil. But within his novels and his mainstream novels, he wrote about people, about relationships, and about the difficulties of relationships as profoundly, powerfully as anybody I've ever read, any novelist I've ever read. But on top of that, what he does is he seems to have this innate ability of understanding society and how society controls individuals. Because one of the themes through all his books, he has many themes, but the theme of the totalitarian state the police state, the idea that we're being watched, that we're being manipulated in some way by the state. You know, I'm reminded again of the book Radio Free Albemuth, you know, which was one of the variations upon the Valis idea. And in that, you know, you very much have the control of the state over the individual. Now, again, there has been an amazing new movie by John Alan Simon that has just come out based upon Radio Free Albemuth. And interestingly enough, they've called it Radio Free Albemuth. And this movie gets across, as well as I've ever seen from what I've seen of the movie, the power of Phil's political stance. But it's as well as that he seems to be a man of our time as much as he was a man of the 70s and the man of the 80s, in that he writes about the world we live in now. You know, and that, again, I find quite strange, in the sense that he is long dead now, sadly. But effectively, the world around us, we are literally now living in a Philip K. Dick world. And as Tessa says, you know, and Tessa has her own blog site, which she's actually calls it the Philip K. Dick world, because we are living within this. You know, the internet, you know, the way in which we have information available to us. We're living in a veritable library of Babel, as one of Phil's favorite novelists, and I know one of your favorite novelists, Jorge Borges, you know. And again, you know, I found, I was thinking there's somewhere here that Phil is going to like Borges. And lo and behold, there are lots of references to Borges. And as you probably know, his good friend, whose name has just escaped me, the female science fiction writer, very much cited Ursula Le Guin, cited Phil and said that Phil was our own homegrown Borges. And it's clear that Phil, again, was writing like Borges. He was writing magical realism. You know, I'm always thinking that if Phil had lived in Argentina or in Latin America during the time, he'd have been up there with Cortazar and Borges.
Marquez,
yes, I was going to say 1,000 Years of Solitude. You know, the whole idea of way Spanish literature seems to love this idea of playing with a basic reality that seems to be real and then suddenly isn't. You know, it's the wonder of Phil's book, The Man in the High Castle. You know, in The Man in the High Castle, effectively, most of The Man in the High Castle reads like a standard novel, until suddenly the Japanese gentleman suddenly realizes for a second that he splits in time, and he suddenly sees the Embrogadero free overpass that doesn't exist in his world, and he suddenly sees a police officer. And again, I think I'm right in saying that the reason that Mr. Tagamoto comes back to the real world, i.e. the world of his illusion, is that the policeman's badge, there's a flash of light from the policeman's badge, which sends Tagamoto back to his reality. But of course, Tagamoto then realizes that he's a character within somebody else's novel. Now, this is like Pirandello. You know, this is incredibly clever stuff. Playing with your mind, playing with what personality is, what, you know, what we are. And of course, Phil then discusses memory and how memory functions. These are all issues that the writers these days are really intrigued by, you know. But Phil was already there. He'd already ticked the boxes. And all I can imagine from reading Phil's writing, and I sometimes feel I have this frustration sometimes as well, that there is so much information out there. And you're putting the dots together, but there is more to know and more to know. And you almost get like Stendhal syndrome. You know, there's so many paintings that, you can't take them all in. And sometimes when you're involved in writing in the fields that we write in, you sometimes get this feeling of you're drowning in information. And you know that the dots are there and you just need to join the dots. But because you are a mere human being, you can't join them. And I think this was Phil's frustrations.
Yes, when John Alan Simon was on the show on Aeon Byte, he pointed out very astutely that also what makes Phil's writing so great is that even though in the movies you have Arnold Schwarzenegger and Tom Cruise, we can all relate to his characters. His characters, despite living in these incredible worlds, are very simple guys like us, you know?
Yeah, it's very much the little man against the big world, you know, and the idea that it's normally a little man thrust into an extraordinary set of circumstances where he has to deal with this. You know, he has this concept of the journeyman, doesn't he? You know, the little man, little cog in a wheel. that really is trying to deal with amazing things. You know, I'm reminded of Ubik, you know, and the central character in Ubik. He's nobody important, but he becomes important. He becomes great because of the things he has to do. And that's why in many ways a lot of the big Hollywood blockbusters of Phil's films really fail, because, you know, the central character in Minority Report is not a Tom Cruise character at all. He's henpecked by his wife. His life is going down the tunnel, down the tubes. He's not a particularly happy individual. You know, the same goes for the Arnold Schwarzenegger character. You know, he's not like Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's not a superhero. He's nothing of the sort. He's somebody way out of his depth, just trying to deal with things. And we relate to this. You know, you want him to succeed. And even in his more esoteric novels, you still have this theme of the little man. Always, he seems to always have this bitch wife that he has to deal with as well, you know, which the theme goes through time and time and time again. Again, I was talking about this to Tony Grassoni. Tony Grassoni is the movie director that was responsible for Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. I think he wrote Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Ironically enough, he wrote it, and an old school friend of mine called Alex Cox also wrote the screenplay. And apparently, if you watch Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, you will see that that both writers are cited. And they're both people I know. You know, I was at school, I was in the Drama Society with Alex Cox. And it was only recently I discovered from Tony about, you know, the way that script had been developed. But Tony was explaining to me, you know, how he was getting into Phil's character to be involved in the movie he was planning to write called An Owl in Daylight. And how, again, he was trying to get the idea of Phil as the small man in a big world. So I think John Alan Simon, from what I've seen of the movie and what John and I have discussed, I think he's got it quite right. He's got the central character right. He's got the idea of the little man who's living in the big world and trying to deal with complexities.
It should be noted, I mean, when you read like the biography, A Life of Philip K. Dick, The Men Who Remember the Future, and other biographies, you're sort of stunned by Phil and his personality disorders, his many phobias like fear of water, his mood swings, his mystic visions when he becomes withdrawn. But most people say, and would you agree with this, that what really struck people about Phil is he was the nicest person you could meet, very sensitive and a great friend.
Phenomenal. That was the complexity of the character. And one of the things that I found reading the letters chronologically and then placing the letters within the narrative of Phil's life and the things that were happening in his outside world, I found it quite strange, because there was this guy that seemed to be incredibly vulnerable. And in the book, you know, I try to avoid potted psychology if I can, because, you know, I don't think it does anybody any credit particularly. But it is clear that Phil, as a child, missed his sister Jane terribly. Whether he consciously missed his sister or whether it was very much a projection from his mother, who clearly felt responsible for the death of Jane, and of course Phil held her responsible for the death of Jane. But, you know, the circumstance that you have a twin that you lose within, what, 9 or 10 days of your birth, and you suddenly feel half-formed. You almost feel like a demiurge in your own way, because you are not a full being. And indeed, again, I can draw parallels with my own life here, because my father was an identical twin, and his brother died in a similar kind of time scale to how Jane died with Phil. And I know from my own father that this causes great psychological tension in an individual, because they just feel part of them is dead. And my father used to sit there sometimes and say, am I Eric or Peter? And I used to say, well, you're the one that survived. Well, yes, but Eric died and I might have died. And I said, well, no, you've had too many Guinnesses. You're thinking too deeply here. But he used to get very, very disturbed about it. Now, is this how why Phil was lonely in certain ways? We have certain descriptions of his childhood. For instance, he writes to a letter to, I think it was Issa, where he describes how when he was a child, kids used to throw stones at him, and he used to have to hide underneath a car so the kids didn't throw stones at him. Now, of course, this was a slight exaggeration, but nevertheless, it was the way he felt about his life and his world. He felt he didn't necessarily fit in. Other people I've spoken to and other authorities I've read material on have said that Phil used to dress quite old-fashioned in his dress in the 1950s. When Cleo met him, he just seemed to be, you know, about 5 years out of fashion, and he was never a great fashion guy. You know, the general descriptions you have of a very big, imposing guy sort of breaking out of his clothes, you know, and this huge hairy chest bursting out of his shirt. So clearly he was a powerful man who used his power and his presence to impose upon people. But by the same token, he was incredibly sensitive to other people's feelings sometimes, particularly friends. I think he sometimes became a little bit insular. And if you read the letters, you can find that he was almost two-faced with people, in the sense that he'd be writing one thing to one person about them and how much he was missing them. And then you'd have the same letter written in the same day to somebody else castigating this individual. So I think what he did was he was grasping and he was looking for things all the time. I think this is why he had many relationships, where he had five wives. And it was clearly he was always looking for something else. He was looking for this lost sister, possibly. But then you have the background and the charm. You know, the people I have spoken to who knew him, this is the thing that comes across all the time, is his how charming he was, which unfortunately doesn't come across necessarily in the interviews we have of him and the videos. But the interviews sometimes, the other thing that people miss is his fantastic sense of humor. He was leg pulling all the time. And I sometimes wonder if a lot of the experiences he describes, in fact, we're just leg pulls. He didn't really mean this. He was seeing how far he could take this and just how far somebody would believe what he was saying.
Yes, I agree. I mean, sometimes people miss the humorous part of his life. For example, the great 2374 experiences where people are going, he mystically look at the girl's fish on a thing. And Tessa's like, no, he was looking at her chest as always.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it again, you know, that one of the major issues about the whole 2374 circumstances is that I spent a lot of time talking to Tessa about this, and the whole 2374, the way it's described in a lot of biographies and a lot of the articles, just basically isn't how it happened. And in the book, I'm going to probably surprise a lot of people, because I'm not towing the line on 2374, in the sense, for instance, the diagnosis of Christopher's inguinal hernia. It is repeated time and time again. The general story is that Phil was lying in his study, listening to Strawberry Fields of Forever by the Beatles. As he's doing so, a pink light comes out of the speakers or something, hits him, and suddenly he hears a voice in his head saying, or the Beatles singing in harmony, that your child has an inguinal hernia, you've got actually, I don't know how he could ever make that scan or make the Beatles say this thing, but clearly, you know, some
Paul's
of the
dead.
Some real obscure John Lennon lyrics, you know, from who knows what, you know, but Lucy in the Sky, it sounds like, basically. But, you know, he hears this voice, and this voice tells him, and of course I've argued in the past this was his daemon, because his daemon was precognitive. But the reality of the circumstances is, I got to know the layout of Phil and Tessa's apartment, because, you know, I'd spoken to Tess, because I'd read the letters, I just had a vague idea of the layout of the apartment. And I know that Phil's record player, his Magnavox that he loved so much, was in the living room. Now, if you read the way Tessa describes it and such like, Phil was in the bedroom. He wasn't in the living room, and he was asleep. So it's unlikely he was listening to a record. He was asleep. So he has this hypnagogic image. And in the hypnagogic image, he hears a voice rather than the record player. Tessa tells me he came running out of the bedroom into the living room, where Tessa and I think I think there was a kind of a living room and possibly an adjoining kitchen. And Tessa was in the kitchen, hears Phil shout, comes out, and there's Phil standing there, agitated, saying that he's had a dream and there's a problem with Christopher. So far, so true. But what Phil then describes, and what a lot of the biographers then describe, is that Phil then says, we have to get Christopher to a doctor because he's got this inguinal hernia and everything else. The voice has told me, I don't know anything about these things, but the voice has said that he's got this birth defect and he's going to die. And the story goes that Phil and Tessa bundle into the car, go rushing off to the doctor's, and the doctor sees what's happening, gets really worried, and then rushes Christopher off, and immediate surgery happens, and Christopher's life is saved because of Phil's prediction. That's not true. Phil didn't go to the doctor's with Tessa. Tessa went on her own, and I'm not sure in the book whether she went that day or she went the next day, but Tessa goes to the doctor's. Now, two things that is less known, that is not necessarily known. The first one is that when Phil was playing tennis many years previously with Cleo, he pulled his groin and he gave himself a form of hernia, a twisted hernia. Phil, being Phil, read up everything he possibly could about hernias and male hernias and the hernias in that area of the body. So to say that he didn't know about this is untrue. He did. On top of this, Tessa has told me that within her own family, this particular birth defect had actually manifested in one of her brothers, possibly two of her brothers. I'm not sure if she had more than one, but definitely her brother had this issue. So Phil would have been very aware, because Tessa would have talked about it. They would have talked about it. Phil would have talked about it. So therefore, he was very much aware of this. They were looking for it. They knew that Christopher had been gripey for quite a few days, and they knew there was something not quite right with him. But the fascinating story then is that the story goes that, you know, there was emergency surgery took place. There was no emergency surgery took place. They couldn't operate on Christopher because he was too young. They had to wait a year before the surgery took place. And the surgery, in fact, was the reason that Phil's famous Rolling Stone interview with Paul Williams was delayed, was because Christopher was due for surgery. And in his letters, I think, to Paul Williams, he actually says, oh, my son has had some minor surgery, but there's nothing to worry about. Indeed, if you read the letters, there's no concern in these letters for Christopher's illness, until suddenly there's a letter right out the blue that he writes to Laura, his first daughter, where he's suddenly explaining, oh, we almost lost Christopher, and we had a Catholic priest and an Episcopalian priest praying over him. That never happened, but it was in the letter. So again, we have this embroidery taking place. So we have to take an awful lot of what Phil says with a pinch of salt. You know, there's the famous statement by Marcello Trulli, which actually says, you know, extraordinary claims need extraordinary proof. So you really have to go back to the source material on these things before you take them at face value.
Anthony, is there any other surprises that you found out in your research about Philip K. Dick that might go against the gospel stories out there?
That probably is the main one. There are a lot of smaller issues. For instance, the idea that the pink light came bouncing off the pendant of the fish sign off the pendant and hit him in the eye and everything. That wasn't necessarily the case either. What actually happened was, as Tessa's described, and again, I've checked this in Phil's letters, and he does reference this in the letters as well. Phil and Tessa had a few weeks previously been downtown, and they bought a Christian bumper sticker, a kind of fish bumper sticker, which they hadn't placed on the car bumper, but they'd placed on one of the back windows of one of the bedrooms in the apartment. And as Tessa explained, what was happening was that the setting sun had caught the bumper sticker and the reflection of the bumper sticker, and it actually reflected into Phil's eyes. And this is what caused the reflection that he saw. There's also evidence that Phil had at that time taken a particular concoction, a particular drug, which name escapes me at the moment, DTM, something like that, which was popular at the time, which I believe he'd actually sourced from the kids next door. And he'd taken some of that one evening when I think it was one of his daughter's important birthdays, and he was feeling depressed. So he took this particular substance, and this substance is known to generate certain sort of strange experiences. It's a possibility that might have been triggered by that.
And Anthony, speaking of the Valis experience, you also bring a lot, and you certainly do a lot of research on it, that probably a lot of people might not know, besides, you know, the usual legend. Like, for example, I really liked how he was already hearing voices from alternate universes. And again, this goes right into your research. Like, for example, he was hearing the voice of an individual called Sadasa Ulna from the United States of Portugal. And being from Lisbon, I thought that was really great.
Yes, I thought you'd like that. Absolutely. And the idea of this peculiar, and this being, this Sadasa Ulna, as you probably know, Sadasa Ulna then reoccurs as a character, I think, in Radio Free Albemuth. But Sadasa Ulna, he actually turns round to this being and says, where exactly are you from? And it says the Portuguese States of America. And then I think Sadasa knows that because she or he or it reads something on a desk, on a table or something, wherever it is, and it says, oh, this is where I'm from. And of course, this in many ways parallels Phil's ideas put forward in The Man in the High Castle, you know, the alternate reality whereby America has been partitioned into the Nazi axis and the Japanese. And clearly, again, it's the idea of alternate histories, alternate universes overlapping each other. But he seemed to be hearing these voices for most of his life, didn't he, really? You know, the voice was with him right from the start. There's the classic tale of when he was doing a physics exam at school, he could not remember the formula for the displacement of water. And the Valis voice, which was the voice he became to know as Valis or AI, supposedly gave him the formula and helped him pass the exam. So clearly there was something manifest inside himself, that he was possibly a dual personality even from that early time.
And for the listeners, obviously for the audience who's interested in Gnosticism, when you read the exegesis, there really is no doubt that that's where he was heading to. I think in one section he says, I am deep into Gnosticism and it's really troubling me. And he even compares himself to the founder of Gnosticism, Simon Magus. So he was already deep into the Gnostic worldview, and obviously he wasn't happy because, like many of us, yourself included, when you take the red pill, it's not a good feeling.
No, absolutely. I was interested to discover, and I read it a few years ago, and I was trying to find more evidence from this from my research this time round, that he was considering writing a novel based upon the life of Meini, which again was intriguing. You know, so it's again the idea of you know, El Twam, the twin, you know, and again he was intrigued by Meini's concept of duality. And I know that he was particularly enamored with the Hymn of the Pearl. And I think I think I'm right in saying that there's a section in the exegesis where he discusses the Hymn of the Pearl. So here we have Phil as the deep-rooted Gnostic, the idea of that reality is a facade and there's a reality behind the reality. Because, of course, you know, right from the early days of his writing, we had this idea of the world as an illusion. You know, I'm reminded of his very, very early novel. What was it called? Where the couple decide to visit his town. Well, I can't think of what it's called now. No, it's not coming to me. But there was a novel he wrote when he was quite young. And the idea of the world is the battleground between two Zoroastrian beings, you know, and the way in which human beings get caught up in all this battle. And of course, he had the ongoing concept of the palm tree garden, which is the I suppose, his version of the Pleroma, and his idea of the black iron prison that we're all trapped within, which was, of course, very much based upon the writings of William Blake, who was yet again somebody else that Phil was quite intrigued and quite fascinated by.
And he certainly was influenced by Carl Jung, another modern Gnostic.
Oh, totally. I mean, I was aware of the way in which he was influenced by Jung, but not quite to the extent that he was. And indeed, not only Jung, but if you carry some of the Jungian work into the work of Ludwig Binswanger, and the existentialist psychiatrist movement. And you read up a lot about Binswanger, you'll find that, again, Phil was very much intrigued by all this, the concept of the tomb world, and the idea, again, of this, the reality behind the reality, where it falls apart and it's all horrible and terrible. And again, he very much takes this theme, doesn't he, in the novel Martian Timeslip, you know, where the little boy, Manfred, is, as Phil terms it, schizophrenic. But I think he was using the term schizophrenia in a very, very generalistic way, because clearly there are elements here of autism, also precognition and such like. And funnily enough, one of the areas that I take the book into is my own idea of exactly what was wrong with Phil. And I can thank here Jamel Morgan, the writer, who wrote the wonderful book A Kindred Spirit, if you've had the opportunity to read it. Do you know about Jamil's work?
No, I do not.
Okay, she's well worth getting on as a future guest. She's written an amazing book called A Kindred Spirit, which takes on, it's a kind of a novel about a young woman who Phil manifests in her mind, basically, for want of a better term. But in one of Jamel's articles in PKD Otako, she discusses Phil and the potential that Phil had a series of what's called transitory ischemic episodes or attacks. And these are very, very small strokes that occur in the brain. Now, one of the things that in my research I discovered was that transitory ischemic attacks and classic migraine are very much related, and indeed a lot of doctors confuse the two. Now, if we take into account that Phil was in fact a classic migrainer, suddenly the events of 2374 take a totally different point of view, because the Kandinsky episode, you know, where he saw all the Paul Clays and the Kandinskys and everything else over a period of 8 hours being flashed in front of his eyes, picture after picture after picture, which, of course, he diagnosed in various ways, including he was believing that Russian scientists were beaming pictures from the Hermitage up at in St. Petersburg, as it now is, but then was it Stalin? No, it was Leningrad, wasn't it? And that they were using experiments to beam thoughts into his head. Now, if you take into account that, in fact, what he was a classic migrainer and was suffering also from precursor ischemic attacks, this would be very much what he would see. He would see the castellations, he'd see the kind of weird images, because Kandinsky himself was a classic migrainer. So what Kandinsky was painting was his migraine images. In fact, in the book, I think I cite the example. If you look back at the works of a lady called Hildegard of Bingen, who was a mystic in medieval times, she had classic migraine, and a lot of the drawings and the paintings she did were very similar, again, to Kandinsky's. So if we assume that Phil was having these transitory ischemic attacks, these were in fact precursors to the stroke that eventually killed him. Now, another interesting aside here is that Phil's his aunt Marion died very young, and she died of a stroke. Well, she didn't. She died of complexities due to a stroke, because she was a medium, and she used to go into trance states. In fact, she suffered from catalepsy, and she used to fall down and go into trance states. And in fact, the reason she died was that her family had assumed she'd just gone into one of her trance states and was convening with the dead, when in fact she was dying, and they didn't call the ambulance quickly enough, and Marion died. Now, here again, we have a family history then of these particular altered states of consciousness and communications with other beings. So clearly we can tie this all in, you know, in a fairly reasoned way as to what was really happening to Phil and what was happening in his brain.
And another issue that you deal with a lot in The Men Who Remember the Future is the fact that Phil believed that people could talk to the dead in seances and so forth, obviously with his friendship with Bishop Peake and all that. How does talking to the dead tie into your work, Anthony?
Very much so, because if you read my previous books, you'll know that I'm very interested in the idea of communication with disincarnate entities. And indeed, in my book, The Mind Field, I discuss the communications that people have when they take DMT. I discuss the way in which people have spirit guides in shamanism. And of course, there's many articles pointing out that Philip K. Dick was a modern day shaman, which of course I think he probably would have been had he been in the kind of society where shamanism was part and parcel and was considered to be important. But on top of that, he very much shows the idea of talking to voices and hearing voices. Now, again, if you read Phil's exegesis, and it's a subject I touched upon earlier on, is Phil was fascinated by the Julian James concept of the bicameral mind. And in 1973, I think it was, that Julian James, who was a Princeton psychologist, wrote a book called The Bicameral Mind, or the Breakdown of the Bicameral Mind. And in this, he suggests that hearing voices is part and parcel of the duality of the brain, and that we hear the inner dialogue that we sometimes consider to be our own thoughts. When we're verbalizing internally, sometimes people hear the internalized thoughts as words within their heads. And Phil was quite intrigued by this as well. But all of this ties in with this idea of mediumship. And as an aside here, my next book that I'm working on at the moment is a collaboration with the Hungarian-American academic Professor Irvin Laszlo. And Irvin Laszlo and I are writing a book on evidence for consciousness outside of the brain. And I've spent the last few weeks dealing and going deeply into mediumship. You know, what exactly is mediumship? What do we mean when somebody is a medium? Who are they communicating with? Is it all delusion, or is there something more? And to me, there is clearly something more. We do have this ability to communicate with other entities, whether they are manifestations of ourselves, which then brings us round to full circle. Because in the book, I very much focus in on Phil's belief that effectively we are all one single, we are all God, and that God has forgotten he's God. You know, it's the central theme in The Divine Invasion, where Manny effectively is God, who's forgotten he's God. Now, Phil argues, and he was very much en route to this, the ideas that are now put forward by people like Bernard Haish and Martin W. Ball, who are positing that, in fact, we are all God. God is a singular entity. God is everything. You know, it's a form of panpsychism, the idea that everything is one single entity, experiencing itself subjectively, which, of course, we move then to the Bill Hicks monologue. And again, this is, you know, and Bill Hicks, of course, and we get that into Gnosticism. And is it the idea, you know, Phil's concept of amnesis, you know, the idea that we have forgotten who we are, which again is a central concept, isn't it, of Gnosticism, you know, the forgetting. And again, you go back to Greek mythology and you have the drinking of the river Lethe, the river of forgetting, you know, that we are supposed to forget, to go back, to be re-embodied again, to live our lives again. Phil, again, was intrigued by all this. You know, it's again, time and time again. I feel I've been writing my work, and anybody would have thought, oh, well, he's just got this because he's been reading Philip K. Dick's work. But of course, Gnosticism wasn't published until, 2 years ago. So clearly it wasn't that. It's just that I've been thinking along very, very similar lines. And of course, we then get the bizarre thing of Anarch Peake, don't we?
Yes, we discussed it in one Schrodinger's diary. I'm still stunned, and it's your book. And I was just thinking of also in Groundhog Day, where Bill Murray goes, maybe God is somebody who's been around so long he forgot he was God. That's right into the Gnostic Philip K. Dick paradigm.
Wow, do you know, I'd never picked up on that line. Ironically enough, I received an email today from Danny Rubin, the guy who wrote Groundhog Day, because, you know, we're going to try and get him on for a future show, and he seems to be up for it. And again, you know, it's intriguing, isn't it, how these elements just keep coming up again and again and again. It's as if the universe is trying to give us a message here, And Phil was trying to give us a message. And indeed, in her book, Jamil Morgan very much goes on about this, you know, that Phil trying to give messages. Now, again, there is evidence. And I think if you read some of the work of Scott Appel, Scott was quite convinced that subsequent to his death, Phil was communicating with him. Now, again, if we take it back to Phil's relationship with James Peake and James Peake's book, The Other Side, we know that Phil and were involved in the seances that Bishop Peake did to try and get in contact with his own son, which, of course, Phil fictionalized in The Transmigration of Timothy Archer. So again, we have this idea of, again, Phil as a spirit communicating with people. And again, going back to Jamie's book, that's exactly what she describes, is Phil's spirit communicating with her. And some people have claimed that Phil has done that, you know, and who are we to say that Phil isn't? You know, it's a question of where you pays your money and it takes your choice, really.
Yes, and to end, Anthony, and I'm sure you've envisioned this, but if you could sit down and have one dinner date with Philip K. Dick across the table and have a conversation with him, is there anything you would ask him that you really want to know?
What an absolutely fantastic question.
It's a hard one, too. I mean, you have a couple hours with Philip K. Dick. What will you say?
What would I ask him?
What's your favorite Beatles album or something like
that? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. What would I ask him? Wow. I think I would like to ask him exactly what he was getting at when he wrote A Scanner Darkly. And again, the dualism in The Scanner Darkly, and did he believe he was two entities, or was this just a literary device? You know, because we know he does it in Valis with Horse Lover Fat and Phil Dick. It's a theme, again, in his books, and I'd like to know a little bit more about that, what he meant by that. But I think that Philip K. Dick would make the most wonderful dinner party guest ever. And as my wife has said, she said either Philip K. Dick and yourself would get on terribly well, or there would be just a battle of egos.
two kindred souls. Too much.
Yeah, but I feel that we have so much in common, and I know most people probably feel that. But in many ways, there are many things that Phil did that are completely I cannot understand. You know, and his treatment of his women, I cannot fathom, you know, and he sometimes was immensely cruel to people, and he seemed to just snap. And, you know, some of the incidents that happened in his relationship with Anne, for instance, and indeed the callous way in which he just seemed to dump Cleo for Anne when he was in Royal Portray Station. You know, it just seemed to be very cold. You know, it's as if this is now my part of my life is now over, and I'm now moving on to the next part of my life, you know, and that's now happened. The other area that I touch upon in my book, which will be new to a lot of people, is the argument I use of Philip K. Dick as an abductee. And I came across a fascinating interview that Phil had done with Brad Steiger, who was a good friend of his. And although Phil isn't identified as such within the particular book, I know from other sources that it was Phil, and Phil claimed that he was a starseed. He believed that in some way he was some form of alien who had been transported down to Earth for one reason or another. Now, again, we know how Phil used to play with ideas, and this was obviously one of his later ideas that he had. But this can then be paralleled with his concept of the plasmate and the homoplasmate and the idea of DNA and DNA carrying on through ourselves. And, of course, it's, again, the central theme in The Eye of the Sibyl. Now, if Phil was an abductee, and I'm using the term abductee here in its generic sense, and in fact, recently I was discussing this very issue with Whitley Strieber, and Whitley knew Phil, and Whitley was also of the opinion that Phil had had similar experiences to what Whitley describes in his book Communion. Also, yes, somebody else who was intrigued by this is Bill Sarrell, his friend. And Bill, as you know, was somebody that Phil worked with. I think it was Galactic Pot Healer. It was one of his very, very religiously based books that he worked very, very close with him. And I can't off the top of my head remember which particular the one it was. I mean, it could have been the Galactic Pot Healer, maybe. But effectively, you know, they come up with this whole new religion, which was based upon sort of alien infections and such like. And there is a degree of evidence to say that Phil could have been. And because, for instance, he seemed to have a theme in his life of Men in Black. You know, when he started to remember the incidents that had taken place when he was up in Vancouver, there was one sequence where he described that he was driven around by men in an unmarked black car, men in black suits. He also claimed that there was one stage in one of his letters, he said that he was visited by a group of individuals dressed in black who claimed to have been representatives of the Soviet embassy one day when Tessa was away. Now, again, you know, is this the men in black theme? So here we have another theme to Phil's life that a lot of people haven't really focused on. But it could just be that Phil was a man of his time. Phil was an eclectic thinker. Phil amalgamated many, many ideas. He had a syncretic way of looking at the world, and he just brought in ideas and put them all together, and he had a galactic pot boiler, and he put them all in them and came out with these ideas. So Phil one day would have one belief, and the next day another.
Yeah, he was certainly a myth maker, a classic myth maker, and an unforgettable person and a great influence on our society. But I think that's all the time we have today, Anthony. I'd like to thank you very much again for a wonderful entry of Schrodinger's diary and for bringing to the world a great biography, The Man Who Remembered the Future.
Thank you very much. Let's hope that the world likes it or not. And I've got my fingers crossed that they will, but you never know. You never know. There is lambs.